Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Father, we thank you first and foremost that we have the opportunity to come into this place. Lord, thank you for this house, that we get to come in and to enjoy the air conditioning and the electricity and all the great things that our modern amenities give us. And Lord, we get to come into this place in the comfort of the amenities and to hear your word. Lord, we don't come into this house for a ritual. We don't come to hear from a man, from the young, or from the old. Lord, we come to hear from you, and we acknowledge that at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, that it's Jesus that's our senior leader. And Lord, in the name of Jesus, we ask today that it wouldn't be the words of a man, it wouldn't be the advice of a person, but Lord, it would be the instruction and the words and the counsel of the Holy Spirit. We ask that your Holy Spirit would be our counselor, would teach us and lead us and guide us and direct us and motivate us to be all that you've called us to be based on your word and on your will, that we might live your will in our lives so that the world outside can see the light of Jesus Christ shining on the inside of us and they would come to know you. Lord, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with here at this church. We are so blessed at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We're honored to have all that we have. Lord, we thank you that you would bless all the churches today across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. We don't ever think of ourselves as better than anybody else, but rather we are co-laborers, brothers and sisters in the kingdom of God, in the body of Christ, working to build your kingdom. So Father, we ask that you would bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and all the churches that belong to all the various denominations that proclaim Jesus Christ as the one and only Son of God risen from the dead. Lord, we thank you for our local Calvary chapels and churches like Harvest and The Grove. And Lord, we ask that you'd lift up Sandals and Water of Life and The Way. Father, we thank you for Emmanuel Baptist and Victory and New Creation and Abundant Living and Oak Valley, Lord, all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are building the kingdom of God. We thank you that we all have a part to play in your kingdom, Lord. To you be the praise, to you be the honor, and to you be the glory. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. Amen. Well, as we prepare today, if you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Hebrews in the 11th chapter. Now, if you don't have a Bible, all right, that's okay. But I just want to encourage you, like, the best place to bring your Bible is to church, okay? Like, that's a really good start. And so if you don't have a Bible, that's all right. If you've got a phone or a device or something like that, you can always access it online. There's that great little app called YouVersion, the Holy Bible, that is in, like, dozens of different languages. You can get that. But whatever you got, however you get it, get into the Word of God. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 11, beginning in verse number 8. Now, we've been in Hebrews 11 chapter, if you're just joining us or you're new to the church, line upon line, precept upon precept. For quite some time, we've been studying the Word of God. And today, we're going to resume our studies looking at the subject of this. I love this. The Hall of Faith. The examples of faith in our life. And we've gone through what faith is and learning all about faith. And I encourage you to go back and refresh that. I mean, we could all use that refresher in our lives. But today, we're going to continue that in Hebrews 11, chapter verse number 8, looking at the story or the life and example of Abraham. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 8, it says, by faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out of the place which he would receive as an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he would go. Today, we're going to focus in on that subject, on that statement. The Bible's going to give us a lot of examples of Abraham and his wife Sarah and their faith, as well as the faith of their family. But today, I want to focus in on that particular verse, verse number 8 here, looking at the faith of Abraham and the example that we can live. You know, my wife and I, we're real outdoorsy people. Everything that we do, we really try to make it about outside, you know, spending time in God's creation and being outdoors. And listen, I understand that there are people that the Lord has created that love the outside. And amen, there are people that the Lord has created that love the couch. All right, I have stopped trying to talk people into going outside. But we are outdoors type people. So everything we do, we just like to be outside. And we just got back from a backpacking trip a couple of weeks ago in the High Sierras, a couple hours north of us in the mountains. And we were deep into the backcountry, and we spent several days walking to this destination, to these lakes that were high up in the country. It was very remote, very isolated by ourselves. And there we spent our day. We had a layover day where we weren't walking all day long to get to our destination. And I remember with our friends and the people that we were with, I see them on the front row today, we were out there, and everybody kind of looked at each other the day that we didn't have anywhere to go. And they were just kind of like, what do we do? Like, everything we've done, we've walked to point A to point B to point A to point B. Every day we've had a journey. Today, we've got nowhere to go. We've got nothing to do. And I was kind of like, that's the point. Like, our lives, there's no phone. There's no internet. There's nothing you can do but just, like, sit and experience what life was like 10 years ago before technology kicked in. So what we decided to do, like any person who's been hiking all day long for days on end, is we decided, let's go for a hike. So we decided, let's go down, there's some lakes, and let's check out the area that we were in. So we walked to these lakes, and we walked on the trail, and on the trail that we were on was a very common trail. I mean, very well used in the mountains. People, thousands of people travel this trail every year, and there's signs that tell you this is the lake, this is the next place. It's like driving on a freeway. Like, you can tell, like, your next destination is 2.4 miles ahead. Like, you know everywhere you're going. There's no way to get lost on this trail. And as we were walking on that trail, we got to a lake, and it was beautiful, and the scenery was great, and the day was gorgeous, and we decided, let's just hang out, let's eat lunch, let's just take some time. And as we decided it's time to go back to our camp and get ready for the evening, we said, you know what, we missed a bunch of different lakes that were in the area because the trail took us on a roundabout way, and let's just follow the river as it goes up, and we'll go from lake to lake to lake back to our campsite. And so we decided to do what we call cross-country travel. There was no trail, there was no laid-out area, there was no map or anything that would direct us. We just had to follow the terrain. And I know some of you are like, oh, I know where you're going. No, we didn't get lost. I'll just tell you that right now. I'm pretty good at what I do. I know it. But one of the things I wanted to say is that as we were venturing, as we were traveling, we're walking on this and everything looks good, and the trail and the terrain looks like it was great. And then all of a sudden around the bend, we wouldn't see it. We wouldn't know it was coming. But then there would be this section of bushes or these trees that you just couldn't walk through, or you couldn't get through with all of your gear. So you'd have to stop and look around and walk around it. And then we'd keep walking again. And all of a sudden we came up to this gorgeous cascading waterfall that we couldn't climb up. And we had to kind of go around it. And we had to cross over the river here and over there. And in this journey, in this this cross-country travel, we realized that there was no map laid out. There was no destination. It was just, you couldn't foresee what was coming around the bend. And it was uncharted territory. And I think our lives are a lot like that when it comes to living life in uncharted territory. As a parent of two very young children, I am constantly in a time of uncharted territory. It's like every day is a new day with my kids. It's like just as soon as we think we got through one thing, all of a sudden you got something new. And all of a sudden you get through that one, and all of a sudden it's something new. Every step is in uncharted territory. And today I want to look at Abraham's example and talk about the subject of Abraham in uncharted territory. Because if we look at the story of Hebrews, the 8th chapter, and the illustration, we'll see that. We can see that God called Abraham out of the land in which he knew, and he went. You see, all of us in every way, in all of our lives, are going to step out in a season of uncharted territory. You're going to face a time in your life when you don't know what the future holds, when, like on my journey, you can't tell what's coming up around the bend, or there's no map, or there's no destination, or there's no GPS coordinates laid out for you. It's a journey, one step in front of the next. We will all live our lives in a season, in a time of uncharted territory. Maybe you're in that place right now. You say, Pastor Luke, you know, my wife, my spouse, or my husband, we're in a season that we've never been in before. It's something totally different, something totally out of the ordinary. We are so right now in uncharted territory. You might even say with my children, you know, they're growing up, or they're about to move out. I've never been in this place as a parent with a child going away to college. Or maybe in your business or in your finances, you're saying, you know what, there's a season right now I'm faced with, or decisions that I need to make in my business. I've never been here before. I've never seen these issues, or I've never seen these opportunities in my life. How about this in our lives? Forks in the road. There's a decision that if I know if I go this way or if I go that way, if I make this decision, my life will be like this, and if I make my decision, my life will be like that, and I don't know which decision to make. I'm walking in uncharted territory. And every day of our lives and our walks with Jesus Christ, let me tell you something, we're going to walk out our lives in uncharted territory. Every step of our faith walk with Jesus Christ is going to be uncharted territory. Why? Because each and every one of us have to live out our lives according to the will of God. And so we've got to learn, and we've got to understand that the Bible gives us some wonderful insight to living life in uncharted territory. We don't have to be afraid. We don't have to worry about it. We don't have to concern and stress ourselves out. Why? Because the Bible gives us some great insight and some great understanding as to what we can do to thrive through uncharted territory. And today I want to look at that in the illustration of Abraham. So looking back at Hebrews, the 8th chapter, the Bible tells us that by faith, Abraham obeyed. You see, Abraham wasn't the very first person in the Bible to step out into uncharted territory. Abraham was not the first person to trust God with his life. Abraham was not the first person in the Bible to exercise what we would call faith. But yet the Bible gives us such a vivid illustration and such a vivid account of Abraham's life. As a matter of fact, Dan was there last week telling us that there's more in the Bible in the Genesis account of Abraham's life than there is about creation itself. God wanted to give us an illustration to follow, and Abraham is that wonderful illustration of life in uncharted territory. A man who left everything he knew and left everything that he had to follow after God. And it says here that by faith, Abraham obeyed. We've learned about why we should obey God and the reasons and the ideas as why we should obey the word of God over the past couple of weeks. But look what it says, Abraham obeyed when he was called. One of the things I think that we can learn when we look to Abraham's life is that obedience is not presumption. I'll just tell you right off the bat, I am like the king of this. There's so many times in my life where it says, you know what, man, I feel like, you know, I want to do something. I feel like God's opening this door over here and the wind is blowing in that direction. So it must be God. And I'm going to presume that God wants me to go here. And you've probably been there before, man, this is God. This is God. This is God. You take a step out. You take a step. You say, man, I'm swimming upstream. This is difficult. And you keep going, okay, God's just trying to teach me a lesson through this and I'm going to grow. And this is God. And this is God. And also, the door slams on your face or the floor falls out from underneath you and you say, God, where were you at? And you start to look back at it. You start to look back at the decisions that you made. You start to look back at the context of that stepping out and you realize, okay, all right. Has anybody ever been there before? Maybe, just maybe, it wasn't God telling me all along. Maybe, just maybe, it was me in my own heart or my own desire or my own will telling myself, this must be God, therefore I'll assume it's God's will and step out on it. You see, obedience is not presumption. God does not want you and I to assume this is what God wants us to do. God is not a God, the Bible tells us, who sows confusion. If you think God's desire for you is to walk about life wandering and groping about in the darkness, hoping that you might feel the direction of what God wants you to do, let me tell you something. That is not God's desire for you. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us in the book of James that if anybody lacks wisdom, how about know what to do? God, decision. God, what do I do with my kids? What do I do with my finances? What do I do with my wife? Hallelujah. If anybody lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. You see, God's desire for you is to know. And Abraham, the Bible tells us in Hebrews, that Abraham stepped out, he obeyed, but it says, when he was called. Abraham didn't just decide one day, well, you know what, maybe God wants me to go to Canaan. Maybe God wants me to do something bigger. Genesis, if you've got your Bibles, go with me to there, to Genesis in the 12th chapter. Let's just read Abraham's calling. Let's just read the moment of God's calling to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, beginning in verse number 1. Now, the Bible gives us Abraham's lineage and all the way up to his father. Now, his father was on his way to Canaan. His father's name was Terah, and he died in Haran. And there Abraham dwelt where his dad died. So now the Bible tells us in Genesis chapter number 12, verse number 1, it says, the Lord said to Abram. The Lord said to Abram. Now the Lord said to Abram. You notice how it didn't say that the wind blew or that the leaves fell or that the water was pointing. It says, the Lord said to Abram. Many people believe that Abraham and his kind were moon worshipers. They were even God followers, but yet God revealed himself to this man and he heard the word of God and he responded on the word of God, just like we talked about how faith comes, by hearing the word of God, accepting it as truth and acting upon it. That is the seed of faith. So God spoke to Abraham and Abraham responded. Obedience is not presumption and hoping and wishing and wanting that maybe this is the will of God. Church, let me tell you something. You need to seek God. Some kids ask me after service, some teenagers ask me after service, Pastor Luke, how do we know? How about this? I love how Andrew Caballa said it on Wednesday night. How about we give God first shot? Amen. Anybody ever been there? Man, I got a big life-changing decision right now. And I'm just going to go for it. I'm going to make the decision because I got to make the decision right now. Decisions based on presumption will always be a gamble. But decisions based on God will always be a guarantee. And so we say, well, I got to make a decision. Then we make a decision. We come back and we say, man, I never even asked God about that decision. Obedience is not presumption. Obedience is seeking after God first. God, what do you want me to do? God, I will wait, like that song we sang today. I will wait upon you, on your answer, because what you say you're leading is what I want to do and where I want to go. So we've got to learn that Abraham obeyed when he was called. Church, God wants you to know his will for you. You have got to seek him to find it. All right, good. Look at what it says in Genesis 12 chapter, verse number 1. It says that God called Abraham to get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house. Get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house. Get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house. God was saying something very deliberate to Abraham. God was saying, Abraham, I want all of you, not some of you. When it comes to living life in uncharted territory, God wants all of you, not some of you. He wants your all, not your some. You see, Abraham, the Bible tells us in Hebrews, he was called out of a land in which he had as an inheritance. Abraham had a name. His name was Abram bar Terah, Abraham, son of Terah. He was given to him what his daddy had as an inheritance. He had a title. He had a business. He had servants. But God said, I want you, Abraham, to leave all that you know. I want you to leave all that you associate with. I want you to leave that which has made you who you are. And I want you to follow me with all of you. And I will give you something great. I will do something in your life. You see, God has called each and every one of us to give him our all, not our some. I love how Cameron was talking about, you know, when the children of Israel were behaving, you're like, what part? He's like, the Old Testament. The Old Testament's not there for senseless or useless or old stories that have passed. You see, the Old Testament is full of types and shadows and leadings and illustrations. And God's calling to Abraham is a shadow, it's a type, it's a illustration of Christ's calling to us. God said, Abraham, I want your everything. Jesus says to us, I want your everything. I want all of you. I don't want some of you. When you're stepping out into uncharted territory, I don't want a wishful thought. I want all of you. And so we can learn that God's calling to Abraham is an illustration of Christ's calling to you and I. So God says to Abraham, Abraham, I want you to go to a place. I want you to go somewhere. And I'll show you. As a matter of fact, I got a little illustration. And I saw Brian. I saw you stood out to me. So can I borrow you today? Come on, man. It's all right. Move at a glacial pace. The clock's not even ticking. So we're good, man. All right. Come on, come on, come on. Everybody, say hi to Brian.
Hi.
Brian, say hi to everybody.
Hi.
Don't be rude, man. All right. So I'm just going to show you a little illustration, just kind of paint a picture for you, okay? Brian, in this illustration, now this is an illustration, okay? It's just visual, right? You're going to be Brian. Can you do that?
I'll try.
All right, cool. And I'm going to be God. I already like this one. This is a good one. This is a good one right here. Okay. Okay, Brian, I'm going to call you. Brian, I want you to follow me. Brian, I got a plan for you. I want you to come. Brian, I want you just to leave it all behind. I want you to come. As a matter of fact, Brian, I've got everything you need. I've even packed your bags for you. Will you follow me, Brian?
Yes.
Will you go to wherever I take you, wherever I lead you, whatever I tell you to do? Will you follow me, Brian?
Yes.
Will you?
Yes.
With all of your heart?
Yes.
Well, here, I look at that. I even got your bag. I got everything you need is in that suitcase. As a matter of fact, though, it's locked because I want you to trust me. And when you need something, I'll get it for you because everything you need, I've got for you. But what's that you say? Oh, okay, all right. Brian says, you know what? I want to follow you, but I've got some things that I want to hold on to too. I got some bags that I wanted to pack. So let's bring them out, boys. Brian has some bags that he wants to take on his journey. All right, okay. Well, it's not that big of a deal, Brian. No big deal. I got you, man. You got a little backpack, a little day pack. All right. You know, this is probably like, you know, your buddies, you know, the people that you used to hang out with. Okay, commuter bag. All right, it's your job, man. You know, like the boss, the climate. Oh, look at that. The beach bag, dude. You got the beach bag. You're probably going to Muscle Beach, man. All right, it's okay. I got you. That makes you who you are, man. I don't even know, got to work on your legs a little bit. It's all right. All right, and look at that. Okay. Oh, man. Oh, look at this. This is getting a little bit bigger, bro. Okay, hold on. You know, maybe that's like what your kid. Brian, dude, for real? Is that your bag? No, man, that's got to be your wife's bag, all right? That's probably your wife. All right, and yeah, for sure, that's your mama's bag right here. I know that for sure. Hey, your bag. But dude, you got another one. Man, okay, hold on. You know, I'll just do this. Hold on. Wash the glasses. There we go. Okay, there we go. All right. Brian, man, dude, okay, here we go. All right. Brian wants the braces, but see, God, I got stuff. I got my stuff. This is what makes me me. This is who I am. These are the things that I've lived through in my life. Brian, follow me. Will you follow me? Will you go with me to a place I'll show you? Yeah?
I'll try.
Oh, come on, let's go. Come on, Brian. Come on. Brian, hurry. Brian, you're leaving your bags behind. Come on, Brian. Brian, come on. Brian. Come on, man. All right, everybody give Brian a big hand. Uh-oh. Get your glasses, man. You see, God says to you and I want you to live life in uncharted territory. I want you to live life in a place, to go to a place that you've never been, to a place that you've never seen, to walk in faith like you've never seen it before, to not know what's going on. I want you, God says, I've given you everything you need. I've given you the Holy Spirit to live on the inside of you. I've given you Jesus Christ to empower you. You've got everything you need. I'm just asking you to follow me and to leave your baggage at the terminal. But what happens is we say, God, I will, I got this, but you don't understand. These my friends have been with me since like kindergarten. I can't leave them behind. And God, you don't understand. My mom told me this about me when I was a kid, and it's shaped who I was. But God, you don't understand. I had that one love of my life that, you know, they said it was better to love and to have lost than to have never loved at all. So God, I got to bring that because that's made me who I am. And God, you know, I don't drink like that no more, but I still can do it because I got grace now. So let me bring that along with me. And all of a sudden, we're carrying all this baggage, going on this journey that God says, I want you to go with me to a place that I will show you, but I want all of you. I don't want you to bring what makes you you. I want you to bring what I make you you. It takes all. See, with God, you're either all in or you're not in at all. And that's even with the faith walk. In the book of James, in the first chapter, when I was talking to him, he says, man, if you don't think you have faith when you ask God, you're not going to get nothing. Why? Because you're either all in or you're not in at all. And Jesus, in the book of Mark, in the 10th chapter, I'll just put it up on the overheads for you. There's a young ruler comes to Jesus and he says, Jesus, clearly you're the Messiah. Clearly you're the teacher. What must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus says, man, you got to do what your mama and your daddy says. You got to look to the book of the law and you got to follow it all. You got to be a good person. You got to follow all the rules and all the regulations. And the young man says to Jesus, I have done all of this since my youth. What else am I missing? The Bible says that Jesus, in verse number 21 of Mark, the 10th chapter, Jesus looks at him and he loves him and he says, one thing you lack, go your way, sell whatever you have and give it to the poor and you'll have treasure in heaven. He says, come and take up your cross and follow me. Verse number 22 tells us that he was sad. He walked away sorrowful. Why? Because he had many possessions. You see, he was carrying on to the baggage. He was carrying on to all the luggage that he had of his life, his wealth, his finances, his image. That's what made him who he was. Some of you in this place today, you're carrying baggage. You're carrying weights. You're carrying things. Man, I got hurt when I was a kid by that one guy, and I'll never get hurt again like that, so I'm going to carry it for the rest of my life. You don't understand what she did to me and how she made me who I am today. You don't know what my teacher said about me, or you don't know what this or that experience that happened to me when I was a kid. You don't even know what happened, and I'm going to carry that because that's made me who I am today, and I get through what I'm doing because of that. Let me tell you something. God says, I want you to leave all behind. Get out of your country, away from your father's house, away from your family, and follow me. He says, leave your baggage at the terminal. We're going on a trip. And when we step out in uncharted territory, we want to carry our, God, I believe you, but my baggage says that that's not going to happen. God, I trust you, but my weight over here says that that may not come to pass. God, I believe that you're going to lead me, But I want answers, and that's why I'm carrying my own things, because I'm going to be prepared for me. When God says, I want all of you, not some of you. All of you, and not some of you. And it's going to be hard, and it's going to hurt to leave your baggage. I mean, the things that make you the way they are, I'll be the first to admit, that stuff's like your blankie at night. It's like your teddy bear. Man, that experience, even though it was so wounding and so hurtful, it's like my comfort because it's the only thing I got left. And so it's going to be painful to let it go. But you don't have to be afraid. Why? Because as we learn from Abraham in uncharted territory, we see that God's incentives will always outweigh the pain. God's incentives will always outweigh the pain. God's, the pain to Abraham is, God says, Abraham, get out, disconnect, leave everything behind. That's the pain. But God's incentives, Genesis chapter 12, verse number 2, God says, I'll make you a great nation. I'll bless you. I'll make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. But he's not even done there. He goes on to verse number 3, and he says, I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. And in you, Abraham, and in you, all of the families of the earth shall be blessed. You see, the incentive so far outweighs the pain. Abraham, you have an identity. You have a title. You are Abram, son of Terah, but I don't want you to just be Abram, son of Terah. He says, I want you to follow me, and I'm going to make you Abraham, father of Isaac. Abraham, grandfather of Jacob, Israel. Abraham, the father of many nations. How about this? Abraham, friend of God. Now all of a sudden, Abram is this man who has no lineage, has no heir to pass on what he has. Now all of a sudden God says, I will change that. Why? Because the incentives so far outweigh the pain. I remember both of my children from day one till childbirth was sick. If you're a man in the house, you need to thank God every day that you are a man. Amen. Some people say, man, oh, the first 3 months, that's the terrible. And then after that, the second trimester, it's like the honeymoon period and everything goes and your face starts to glow and everything's going to be good. And let me tell you something, from day one to birth with both of our children, it's not even 9 months. They tell you 9 months, it's like 10 months. All right. From day one all the way up to the day that my little kids were born, Stacy's pushing in between her contractions. Doctor says, push. She pushes and all of a sudden she gets sick. Blah, and she's throwing, they got IVs and all. Terrible. But then all of a sudden, she sees Bjorn, or they put Emma on her chest. And that 10 months of hell, that 10 months of sickness, of emotions and the up and down and the cravings and the and all the different things that are going on, the 10 months of discomfort, 9.5 months, whatever, all of that goes away because the incentive outweighs the pain. She'll never forget it. But at the same time, now she looks at her little baby. Now she looks at her little son and her little daughter and she says, my goodness, you were worth it. My goodness, you were worth it. You were worth every moment I was sick. The incentive outweighs the pain. It's gonna hurt. It's gonna cost you. But let me tell you something. That's not a reason to be afraid or to shy away from. Why? Because God's incentives will always outweigh the pain of what he calls us to do. That's why Jesus says, I have come that you might have life and more abundantly. He says, come all who are thirsty and drink and you will not thirst. Why? It might cost you to let go of what you've been drinking, but once you drink the water of life, you won't thirst anymore. The incentives so far outweigh the pain. God knows this about you and I. He knows us intimately. In that story of the rich young ruler in Mark, the 10th chapter, and look what it says. Jesus looked at him and loved him. He knew right off the bat where this young man was at. Because he says, you lack this. Go and sell whatever you have and give it to the poor. Here's his incentive. You will have treasure in heaven. He knew this man was associated with wealth, with riches, with treasure. And he says, get rid of that which with the moth and which rust will destroy and sow into me and come into the kingdom of God and you will have an everlasting treasure. Jesus knew exactly what this young man needed and he met him where he was because the incentive will always outweigh the pain. So we journey. It's going to cost. It's going to be hard. Jesus in Matthew, the 11th chapter, you've probably heard of it. He says, come to me, all who are heavy laden, and you will find rest. At the end of the statement, you know the verse. He says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. But did you notice Jesus didn't say my yoke is non-existent and there is no burden? He didn't say that. We get into our mindset, I'm going to step into uncharted territory. And it's going to be daisies, rainbows, and unicorns, and butterflies. But Jesus didn't say, come and follow me and take my yoke upon you. And you won't feel anything. You won't have anything. He says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus says, hey, listen, I got luggage for you to carry too. It's called a cross. But let me tell you something. The cross weighs a lot less than all of that you've been carrying. Because I didn't create you to carry that. Your shoulders were created to lift the burdens of your life all throughout the 80-something years you might live on this earth. Jesus says, I've got a burden for you. It's light, it's easy, and it's a heck of a lot better than that. You just got to come to me. To know that God's incentives always will outweigh the pain. But Pastor Luke, I'm stepping out into this uncharted territory. I'm in this place with my wife. I feel like my spouse, I don't feel like I could take another step. My children, I'm at my wit's end about what to do with my kids. My business, I can see the answer. If I just could stop giving for a little while or stop doing this, then I can get the answer and I'll come back. Or I'm at the fork in the road of my life. I know that I need to make this decision and I need to make this decision, but I just don't know. And how do I do it? How do I make this decision? How do I step every day into uncharted territory? The answer is simple. Not easy, but simple. Don't you love it when your life is falling apart? Don't you love it when everything's going away, everything's happening, everything's crashing on you and your brother and sister in Christ? You come to church and they see it on your face. You're looking all sad, looking all, you know, beat up by the devil. And they say, oh man, brother, cast your cares on the Lord, for he cares for you. Oh, your life's falling apart. Children are serving the devil. Cast your cares on the Lord, for he cares. Don't you love it when somebody says it to you? Because I'm always like, man, you need to step away. Why? I don't know about you. Maybe I'm the only person in this place. But it seems like my cares don't work like a baseball. They work like a boomerang. I want to throw them to Jesus, and they come back and they hit me in the head. How do I cast my care? My life is falling apart. I got that decision. My marriage is in trouble. But oh, cast your care. Casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. That's the answer, Pastor Luke said, to cast your care. How do I cast my care? Because when I throw it, you know what I end up doing? I end up chasing it. No. I'm sorry, man. It's mine. So how? Well, the answer is so simple. Because we look at this verse and we like to quote this verse to each other all day long. Cast your cares, for he who cares. Do you notice that the C right there is a lowercase? Because this is the middle of a sentence. Man, I don't like it when they do that on the news. When they take that politician's speech and they take like three words out of his sentence and they're like, he wants to end the world because he said that. But you look at the context of what he said. Man, I really don't like it when people do that about Jesus. Well, Jesus said, read what he said, not just the three words. So we like to say, hey, man, the answer to you is to cast your care upon him who cares for you. That's the answer. The answer lies in the previous verse that it's connected to. 1 Peter 5:6, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God that he might exalt you in due time. Now, casting your cares upon him who cares for you. Humble yourselves. Pastor Dan talked about it last week, and why obey God? Why? Humbling is submitting, coming under, saying, God, it is no longer about the decisions that I want. It is no longer about the things that I want. I am not going to carry my baggage because you told me not to carry it. I'm going to leave it at the terminal, and I'm going to take what you want me to take. I'm going to give you all of me. Therefore, the things that I want are secondary to what you want. I will submit my life to you, and in submitting my life to you, what I have essentially done as put myself under the yoke of Jesus. Remember Matthew? My yoke is easy and my burden is light. And now all of a sudden, because I am yoked, I am connected, tied in to the shoulders of the one who holds the world up, all of a sudden the burdens of my life don't seem that heavy because I've got help. All of a sudden the weight of my unknown territory, of the decision that's looming over my head right now, over the season of my life that I just don't see like there's a light at the end of the tunnel. All of a sudden, all of that gets a little bit lighter. Why? Because now I have submitted to God and I realize, you know what? I am connected and yoked up to Jesus, and his burden is easy and his yoke is light. And now I can get through life. Now I can step into uncharted territory. Now I can say that thing that held on to me all my life, I can let it go. Why? Because I got Jesus. I can take that step when it doesn't seem like I can take it. Why? Because I got Jesus. Because he called me, and I'm gonna give him everything. I'm not gonna presume. I'm gonna seek him. I'm gonna go to him first, not last. I'm gonna give him everything of me, not some of me. And I'm gonna realize that when God calls me, and the call has gone out to you, church, for God so loved the world, not just a little bit of person here and a little bit of here. God so loved you, the call has gone out. Now all of a sudden you realize my incentives are so much better that it's gonna cost me. But like my wife looking at that baby, man, my life will never be the same. And it was so worth it in the end. And we can get through life. Because you see, church, it's not God's desire that the pastor be the world changer. Our society, it's great, it's wonderful, and I love what God's been doing, and I believe it's the move of God. But our society, we're lifting up these men in these pulpits. Man, look what so-and-so's doing over here. Look what Pastor Joel's doing over here. Look what Pastor Judah's doing over there. Look what Pastor Stephen's doing over there. Look what Pastor Brian's doing over there. And these men have the answers. You see, God's desire is not that the pastors be the one that changed the world. That's not God's desire. What? No, God's desire is that the church be the one that changed the world. The church be the ones that changed the world. That we do this together. Not about me, not about Pastor Dan, Pastor Jim, or anybody else, but you and me getting out into our city, to our families, to our workplaces, to our finances, to our children, and reflecting the glory of God, that they might look at us and they say, man, you are in uncharted territory, yet you seem to be doing pretty well. How is this possible? Jesus. Because we proclaim the Inland Empire shall be saved. It's not going to happen because of me. We proclaim that Jesus Christ is going to touch the world and move on the world and see this great revival. It's not going to happen because of me or because of Bill Hybel or because of Joel Osteen. It's going to happen because you and me allow God to influence us, to direct us, to lead us. When our faith seems low, that we say, you know what? I'm going to give it all to God, not just some. I'm going to leave the doubts and the worries and the troubles and the baggage behind, and I'm going to give it all to God and follow him. One step at a time, one day at a time, and I can make it in uncharted territory. Because God's desire for you, like Abraham, an example, is to not just make it through from point A to point B. Man, Abraham walked right through the promised land and made it up in Egypt. We'll talk about that in a couple of weeks. Abraham got blessed. Abraham got blessed. He thrived. He succeeded to the point where the land could not even contain him and his nephew Lot anymore. Why? Because God's desire for you in uncharted territory is to thrive, to excel, to succeed, to make it through life. Jesus says, I have come that you might have life more abundantly. The incentives will always outweigh the pain. We just got to trust God in everything that we have. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Amen. Here's what we're going to do. I want to do things a little bit different. I know everybody's like, oh, that's my cue to run. It's not yet. Okay, I promise. I'm going to do things a little bit different. I'm going to ask you all just to remain seated. I'm going to throw the order out of order, all right? We're going to do this. I just want you to take a moment. And I'm going to do it a little differently, so bear with me, all right? I want everybody to bow your heads. Because I want this to be about you. Not the person next to you, not what's going on, not what you hear behind you. Bow your heads. If you want to close your eyes like they say, bow your heads and close your eyes, whatever. See, the Bible says, with God, you're all in or you're not in at all. And there are those of you in this place that you know. You've been there before, you're here right now. Say, you know what, man, I'm walking in this uncharted territory. I've got this decision in my life, and I don't know what's going on, and I don't know what to do, and I don't know where to go. I don't know who to seek, and I just kind of found my way here. With God, he wants your all, not your some. What happened to us is somewhere along the lines, we thought that this was kind of a game, that if I could attend church enough, if I could sing a song or if I could pray a prayer every once in a while, or, you know, I could read a book or a Bible, and that I could get a point. And every time I get a point, if I could stack up enough points, that would make it good enough for me to win. But can I tell you something? Nowhere is this a game. Nowhere is this about stacking up points or earning brownie points or penance or anything like that. You see, with God, He wants your all, not your sum. Some of you are in this place today. You've been coming to church for years. Some of you are in this place and you're here for the first time. And you realize as you look into your life and your position with God and your relationship with God, you say, I haven't given God my all. I've only been given God my sum. I've only been given God a little bit. You know, I've always thought that I was going to be right with God. Did you know that nowhere does it say that you can think that that's okay? That's giving God your sum. Well, I went to church as a child. My parents told me I was a Christian. That's giving God your sum. My mama brought me up in church. That's giving God your sum. You see, God doesn't want your mama's religion. God wants you. And there are those of you in this place, you've been carrying around baggage. You've been carrying around the weight of life. You've been trying to fill the emptiness on the inside of you with relationships, with money, with possessions, with reasons to live, with jobs. No matter how much you try to fill the emptiness on the inside of you, you realize that nothing can fill that. Why? Because it's a God-sized hole. The only thing that can fill that God-sized hole on the inside of you is Jesus. Today, I want to give you the opportunity to examine your heart, to examine your life and your position with God. Have you given Him your all? Because that's the cost. There's pain involved in giving Him your all, but the incentives outweigh. Jesus says you'll have life. It's not about what happens when you die. That's great, that's wonderful, and that's so important. But even more so right now, it's about what happens right now. And there are those of you in this place, you have not yet given to God your all. And you know it. We like to say it like this: I know I should, and I'm so guilty of this, but I don't. I know I should, but I don't. I know I should, but I haven't. Listen, if that's you in this place, I want to love you enough and respect you enough today to tell you the truth. It doesn't have to be the answer. It doesn't have to be your final solution. In the book of John, Jesus, speaking to a religious leader, He says, man, in order to see the kingdom of God, you must be born again. You see, you got to realize that nothing of the flesh will ever access spiritual kingdom. That your flesh, your good intentions, your good desires, the good works that you do for humanity, nothing in the flesh will ever access or unlock the spiritual kingdom. Jesus says, in order to unlock, in order to see the kingdom of God, you must be born again. What does that mean? It means from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, you've given your, from the, it means the same thing all the way through the Bible. It means this, that you've given God all of your heart, you've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through His Son, Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus in the book of Revelation, it's His final plea to the church. It's His final statement to you and I on the condition of humanity. And He says, you think that you're doing so well. You think that you're so wealthy. You think that you're clothed in fine linen, but you don't realize how starving and how naked you are. He says, oh, I wish that you would come to me. He says, I'm going to return. And when I return, I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. And I know it's a shocking statement. And it's His final plea to get our attention. Church, humanity, people, stop trying to do life your way. I came for a better way, but you got to start doing it my way. By leaving the baggage at the terminal and going with me in uncharted territory. See, the Bible says that the gift of God is eternal salvation. Like any gift, you've got a choice. Somebody gives you a gift, you don't like it, you can take it back. You can give it away. The gift of God is eternal salvation. It's your choice. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force His way in or make His way into your life. He's done everything He could by giving Jesus to die on a cross for our sins so that we could be reunited with Him, reconnected with Him. In righteousness of Jesus. But it starts by accepting that gift. You see, Jesus said these words. He says that if you confess Him before men, He will confess you before His Father. But if you deny Him, He says, I will deny you. Today I want to give you the opportunity right here with asking everybody to bow their heads. And the reason I said that is because I want this today to be more about you than anything else. And I want to give you that opportunity. You see, I'm a man and I'll do something for you in just a moment. I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. I'm going to ask you to do something bold with everybody's heads bowed. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. And what you're doing is you're saying, you know what, I want to make that decision today. I want to follow Jesus. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. I want to answer the call of God on my life today. I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. Say, I don't know, man. I don't know if I can do that. Listen, today is the day of your salvation. You've had doctors and dentists and DMV appointments. Today it's a divine appointment. You're here. For this reason, stop doing life your way. You're tired of it as it is. It's time to accept life through Jesus Christ, to accept eternal life through his salvation. And it starts by making that decision. In a moment, when I count to three, if that's you, I just want you to pop your hand up. I'll see it. If you're out around the campus and you're in the foyer, you can pop your hand up. An usher will see you in the Love Rock Cafe. They'll see you. Even if you're at home watching on the live stream, you know, there's a little blue button. If you minimize the screen, you can click. It's called Know God, and somebody will pray with you. Today is the day of your salvation. Who should raise your hands if you've never given him your heart, you never given him your life? If that's you in just a moment, when I count to three, pop your hand up. Make that decision today to give him your heart. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child in the youth group. Maybe you went to the Harvest Crusade and prayed that prayer with Pastor Greg before, but you've never really followed through with it. Listen, if that's you today, don't walk out of this place with presumption, because decisions based on presumptions are always gambles, but decisions based on God are always guarantees. Today, ensure your place with God. Make sure today. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God, saying, listen, you've been playing that church game, coming to church, playing the part, right afterwards, when you go to lunch, you're back to who you are, and you're tired of it. Come on. Stop playing games. Stop messing around with God. Today is the day of your salvation, to surrender your heart, to leave the baggage at the terminal and go with God every step of the way in this uncharted territory we call life. Because you can. But it starts by making that decision. All across this auditorium, from the front row to the back row, side to side, wherever you're at, if that's you in this place, I'm speaking to you, the Holy Spirit speaking to you right now. It's time for you to answer the call. Like Abraham heard the call and he answered. Now God is speaking to you right now. And it's time for you to answer that call. And when I count to three, I want you to make that decision. We'll follow through together right afterwards. But you start by making that decision. I'm a man, I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. Wherever you're at, this is your moment. This is your time. I'm going to count to three. And when I do, if that's you, come on. Let's do this together. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. I got you guys back there. 11 right over here. 11 wise people. 12, I got you right there, my man. 13, I got you. 13 wise people. 14, I see you right over there. 15, I see there in the back row. 15 wise people, if that's you. It's not about what's going on around you. It's about you right now. 15 wise people. I see the ushers pointing. Give me a little wave so I can see you. I got you. 16. Where are you at? You say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. Anybody else in this place? Usher's pointing in this direction. I got you right there. All right, I see you. Anybody else in this place? You say, man, I wonder if I should. In the family room. All right, what is that? How many in the family room? Two, three, four? Two? All right, see, I can't even see. Two wise people. Anybody else? You say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes, the Spirit of God is speaking to you. It's time for you to respond. I'm not embarrassing them. I'm not going to embarrass you. It's your time, your call. It's time to accept the life of Jesus Christ. Anybody else in this place today, say amen. I wonder if that's me. If you wonder if it's you, it's you. It's time. Come on. Come home to Jesus. Make that decision today to choose life. Anybody else? I'm going to close it up today. Well, praise God. Hallelujah. I don't even know how many I counted, but God is good. Now, here's what we're going to do. For all of you that raised your hands, you say, I'm making a decision. Yep, you are. Amen. Praise God for that. Congratulations. You know this. It's common sense. Every decision that you make requires action. Why? Because you can make decisions all day long. I decided to be a millionaire. If I don't do anything about it, it's not going to happen. You're making a decision. Now it's time to follow up together. We're going to do this together. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand in just a moment, if that's you in this place, or maybe you said, I should have, but I didn't, it's not too late. I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you've got family, somebody next to you, see, you felt that person raise their hand. Say, man, come on, I'll go with you. Or if you raise your hand, but you don't want to do it alone, that's okay, that's great. You've got friends and you've got family. Look to them and say, you know what, come on, will you go with me? And I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle and come meet me right here. Because we're going to change destinies together. We don't want you to leave this place empty-handed and think that everything's okay because you raised your hand in a church service. It's time to surrender your heart, and we're going to do that together. To celebrate together. So as we do, if that's you in this place, if you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible. You need a friend if you need a friend. Get out of your seat. Get out of your chair. Perry's going to sing a song. Let's all stand together. Please don't anybody leave right now. I'll let you out in just a couple of minutes. I promise. But if that's you in this place, in the back row, in the front row, wherever you're at, family rooms, if that's you, come on, come meet me right here. It's time to make that choice.
Feel you have it all.
Come on. You can come.
Have it all. My heart is yours.
You can come on. If you raise your hands, this is your moment. God bless you, brother. Hang right here for me. That's you. Come on, you come. You come. That's it, they're still coming. We'll wait. You're worth waiting for. Well, hey guys, listen. First and foremost, I gotta tell you something. Maybe you've never had somebody tell you in your life. Maybe you've never had somebody encourage you, but somebody's need to tell you something. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Say, I don't know, man. I messed up my whole life. Hey, starting today. Good job. Somebody needs to tell you. You're doing good. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is going to do a couple of things with you. I said, you're making that decision now. It's time to follow through with that action. He's going to do a couple of things with you. He's going to take you guys right over there. Listen, nothing weird goes on, I promise. Look at all my dusty luggage, man. I'm as weird as it gets, all right? You made it through me. He's going to take you guys right over there. Here's what he's going to do. He's going to do a couple of things. First and foremost, he's going to lead you in a prayer. You're going to invite Jesus Christ to be the Lord and Savior of your life. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? To leader, to submit your life to Jesus. You're going to give your life to Jesus in a prayer, okay? He's going to lead you in a prayer. Real easy to do. Second thing he's going to do, we don't want you to leave here empty-handed. We want to get you equipped, empowered to be who God has called you to be. My daddy, Pastor Jim, who founded this church, he wrote a little book, real easy to read. You can probably read it in 45 minutes. We even got a kid's version. And it's just going to help point you. You're going to walk out of this place and say, what do I do next? We're going to point you in the right direction to set you off in that journey in uncharted territory. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. He's going to introduce you to a friend here at the church, somebody that will meet with you right before church service or right after church service. They'll buy you a cup of coffee or get you a soda right there in our cafe. You don't pay nothing. You don't do any of that. You just show up, sit with a friend, and they'll teach you some things about the Word of God for just a couple of weeks. You're not joining some big, long program or committing to something. You're just meeting with a friend to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything that God has for you. And I want to encourage you, come on, hang out with us. The best place to be is where you're hearing from the Word of God. And you heard from the Word of God, that's why you're here today. Come on back, meet with us, get connected with a friend. He'll do that with you today. And watch God move in your life. I promise your life is never going to be the same. Good job. Congratulations. So if you guys can just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.